Two devoted hearts are bound by the enchanting ties of matrimony. These evidences of purity of heart and contentment of mind for all the future are made more sure when the contracting parties enter into this glad time adorned in the robes of reverence, humility, and faith, seeking the blessings of our Heavenly Father. Marriage is God's first institution for the welfare of the race. In the Garden of Eden, before the temptation and the fall of mankind, God saw that it was not good for man to be alone. So he made a helper suitable for him. Not from a bone from his feet, for he was not to walk over her, nor a bone from his head, for she was not to be above him. But from his side, close to his heart, to be a helpmeet and a partner to him. And God established the right of marriage. Originated in divine wisdom and goodness, designed to promote human happiness and holiness, this rite is the foundation of home life and social order, and should remain so until the end of the age. It was sanctioned and honored by the presence of Jesus at the marriage in Cana of Galilee, and marked the beginning of his wondrous works. It is declared by the Apostle Paul to be honorable amongst all. So it is ordained that a man shall leave his father and his mother and cleave unto his wife, and the two shall be one flesh, united in hopes and aims and sentiments and in all the interests of this present time. Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
I do.
You see my bride? Noah, you received Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord and dedicated your life to follow and serve him?
Yes, I have.
Grace, Have you also received Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord and dedicated your life to follow and serve Him? Yes. Noah and Grace stand here whole, clean, and pure because they have put their faith and their trust in Jesus Christ and in His payment for our sin on the cross. They are new creations in Christ, seeking to live a life empowered by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, reflecting Him individually and together through their lives. They believe that God has brought them together and has led them to this decision to unite them in marriage before Him and before all who are gathered together today to be witnesses of this event. So in this estate, these two persons come now to be joined together. And if any person present can show just cause why they may not be legally joined together, may they speak now or forever after hold their peace. I like to do this, I like to ask this, not because I expect any negative responses, although I did do a cowboy wedding one time, and there was a horse that was right about over there, and when I asked that question, the horse responded. But since there is no interpretation of the tongue, we just let it go. So I like to ask the question, not because of that, though. One of the reasons that I ask is because you are here today as a witness. And you're also here not only as a witness, but you're here to pray for them. You're here to encourage them. Because any of us who have been married any length of time, we know that life has a lot of ups and downs, a lot of trials and tribulations. And in today's climate and in today's world, all too often, we're encouraged just go do something else. And we know, according to Scripture, that it takes work, it takes dedication, and this is the commitment that you're making. So you guys out there are committed to encourage, support, and pray for the two of them as they go, just till Jesus comes. This is what it's all about. I was going to say for a long, long time, but I'm ready to go.
I'm sorry to tell you that.
Noah, will you have this woman to be your lawful wife, to live together after God's holy ordinance in the holy state of matrimony? If so, I require you to vow to love and to cherish her, to honor and to sustain her, in sickness as in health, in poverty as in wealth, in the bad that may darken your days, and in the good that may light your ways, and be true to her in all things until death alone shall part you. If so, say I will. I will. Grace, we have this man to be your lawful husband, to live together after God's holy ordinance in the holy estate of matrimony. If so, I require you to vow to love and to cherish him, to honor and sustain him in sickness as in health, in poverty as in wealth, in the bad that may darken your days, and in the good that may light your ways, and be true to him in all things until death alone shall part you. If so, say I will. In Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verses 9 through 12, it reads, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him. And a threefold cord is not easily broken. Some very practical wisdom in Ecclesiastes in reference to two people coming together. Some things aren't necessarily covered by Solomon, though. And so we pull some other things out of Scripture in relationship to these things. We do understand that you're to enter into that relationship with Jesus Christ and establish yourself upon him individually and together. As you do so, he will tie you together, he will grow you together, and he will strengthen your relationship with one another. He, to me, is that threefold cord, and that threefold cord is not easily or quickly broken. So I have my admonition to you, to both of you, which you've basically exampled over the last few years, is to continue to seek the Lord, continue to grow in him, continue to be obedient to him, continue to hear his word, and continue to minister to one another in love and encourage one another in that growth and in that relationship. Ephesians chapter 5, starting in verse 1 and 2, it tells us, therefore, be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us, and given himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. So this is our example. This is who we're to emulate within our lives, especially as we interact with one another, with our spouse. We're to be imitators of him as dear children. See then that you walk circumspectly. We jump to verse 15, excuse me. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. God wants you to live this life in wisdom, in the nurture and admonition of him, and understanding what he would have you to do and how he would have you to interact with one another in all areas of your life. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not be drunk with wine, which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. That's how you do the things of the Lord. You're filled with the Spirit, not with the things of the world. And he will lead and guide you in all truth. Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and submitting to one another in the fear of God. Now we enter into an area that and today a lot of people don't like to hear. We would like to exclude this from Scripture oftentimes in our modern society, but it's here and it's important. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. First thing, it says to your own husband, not to any other husband, not to any other man, as you do to the Lord. Submission is looked upon oftentimes in our culture as a bad word, but scripturally it's coming alongside voluntarily and helping to carry a burden. And actually it refers to a military term where one who joins the military submits themselves to the authority and the leadership of another, and it is still a voluntary task. And so you're to submit to your own husband voluntarily, as he would lead and guide and direct. For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church. Now you have an example that you're to follow, and that example is Christ and how he leads and how he guides. And we're told a little bit about that in Ephesians here. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify, set her apart from anything else that is common, sanctify her and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word. So it's your responsibility to continue to draw her to Jesus Christ and to the word, to encourage her and strengthen her in that. And this will be the result of that. I love this. That he might present her to himself, a glorious church. See, you do your part and she responds. The way God basically wired us and made us is he, in general, makes man the initiator and the female the responder. He examples our relationship with him in that we love him because he first loved us. And as you love her and do these things, she will respond to that. Because she'll know she's set apart. She knows she has a position that cannot be filled by anybody else, period. That he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives. Once again, their own wives, nobody else's. Their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. And that's something for all you guys to think about who are married. Just that statement alone. If you love yourself, you'll love your wife, and you do love yourself. Anyway, he who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. So you can nourish and cherish her, just as God does us. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and his bones. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother, and be joined to his wife, and the two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and see that the wife respects her husband. That also means that you're to love him, but we guys have really fragile egos, you know? And so we need those egos stroked often and told how great and wonderful we are, what a great provider, etc. You know? So, you know, build them up. Even though he might seem like he's, you know, very self-assured and confident, you know? And he's just out. He quit maturing at 7 years old, just like the rest of us guys. He's got issues. Anyway,
I know.
See that you respect your husband. May I have the rings, please? From days of old, rings have been used to seal important covenants. Precious metals are commonly used to symbolize both the beauty and the importance of this union. A ring is also obviously a circle, which symbolizes also not just the continuance, because there is no end in that circle, but also the sanctity of the union that you're entering into. You're to stay within the circle of the symbolism of what this ring represents. So no, take that ring, please. And as you place it upon Grace's finger, please repeat after me. I, Noah, take you, Grace, to be my wedded wife.
I, Noah, take you, Grace, to be my wedded wife.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
For better or worse.
For better or worse.
For richer or poor.
For richer or poor.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
And according to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
I can't believe how many people just phase out on that one. I give you my vow.
I give you my vow.
Grace, if you take this ring, and as you place it upon Noah's finger, please repeat after me. I, Grace, take you, Noah, to be my wedded husband.
Grace, take you, Noah, to be my wedded husband.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
For better or worse.
For richer or poor. Richer or poor.
In sickness and in health. To love and to cherish, till death do us part. And according to God's holy ordinance, I give you my vow.
As the first act of pledging their vows to one another, knowing Grace desired to celebrate the Lord's Supper together, so I'm going to get out of the way while they do that and just explain a few things.
We're told in the Bible by Jesus that we're to do this communion in remembrance of him. Not only does this bring honor to Jesus by our partaking, but it reminds us of the great price that was paid by our bridegroom for us, his bride. In the traditional Jewish marriage custom, a bridegroom or a friend of the bridegroom would present a marriage contract or the bride price to the prospective bride, and he would then place a cup of wine before her. If the contract was acceptable to the prospective bride, she'd take that cup and she would drink it. This is emulated in the Passover, and it's called the cup of acceptance in the Passover ceremony. I lost it all. Jesus is our bridegroom, of course, and his bride price would be his life. And when we are born again, we accept that bride Christ, or that bride price. But there's a day coming when we as believers, even as they together have celebrated communion and the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, that we're going to sit with him and he's going to place that cup before us. And we're going to get to take that cup and accept that face to face with him. And that's pretty awesome. Would you join us in prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, bless these your servants, this man and this woman, that they may live together faithfully and keep the vows and the covenants they have made with one another before you. And may they ever remain in perfect love and peace together and live according to your leading. Therefore, whom God has joined together, let no man put asunder. You may kiss the bride, and you may kiss the bridegroom. Thank you. in holy wedlock together and have witnessed the same before God in this company and have given and pledged themselves to one another and have declared the same in the giving and the receiving of rings. It is my honor and my pleasure to pronounce that they are husband and wife in the name of the Father and the Son of the Holy Spirit. I now present to you Mr. and Mrs. Johnson.
We cut the legs off of our